This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for this program is made possible in part by the WKNO Production Fund, the WKNO Endowment Fund, and by viewers like you. Thank you.
Amy Weirich was appointed by Governor Bill Haslam, the Shelby County District Attorney, in January 2011. General Weirich is the first female to hold the office in Shelby County. Prior to that, she served as Deputy District Attorney under Bill Gibbons. Weirich, who started in the DA's office in 1991, has been Chief Prosecutor of the Gang and Narcotics Prosecution Unit and Division Leader for the Special Prosecution Unit in Criminal Court. Welcome to Newsmakers.
Thanks for having me here.
When did you first want to become a lawyer?
Well, it wasn't really as much that I wanted to become a lawyer as I wanted to become a prosecutor. And I knew that to be a prosecutor, I had to be a lawyer first. And I can't remember any single aha moment. It wasn't from reading To Kill a Mockingbird, as you usually hear from so many people.
Right.
I just remember growing up, you know, as reading the newspaper and watching the evening news, the way that we got information back when I grew up many, many years ago, that the prosecutors seemed to be the good guys and seemed to be the ones who enjoyed doing what they did.
And you grew up here in the Memphis area?
I did. I moved here from Kansas City when I was 13 years old. We moved here the week that Elvis passed away. And I remember standing in our home with boxes all around us and watching all of that tragedy unfold on the television.
Mm-hmm.
And I was born in Minnesota.
Mm-hmm. And your parents, were they in the law or at all?
No.
Yeah.
No, not at all.
And for a lot of people who go to law school, there's a certain number, or the perception at least, that they go into law school with hopes of pursuing, you know, an ideal career. They go into a prosecutor's office and they leave pretty soon. Your whole career has been in the prosecutor's office.
It has. Yeah, and I would say that a lot of those people probably never worked in our district attorney's office. We have, I think, one of the best district attorney general's offices in the country, and for the most part, we are made up of career prosecutors, people who have come there and made that their life decision. A lot of times what turns people away or, you know, runs them off is the fact that you don't go into the practice of prosecution or criminal work to make a lot of money. You're not going to get rich working there, but it's very satisfying and it's very rewarding.
You satisfying and rewarding, I think the perception sometimes that people run off in part because it's difficult and it's hard work.
It is.
And you deal with some of the worst folks in society. I mean, what has that been like over 20 years, seeing some of the worst gang and narcotics unit, as I said earlier? How is that? Is that worn on you? How has that been?
I guess I would like to say that it hasn't worn on me. I don't know if those closest to me have said, you know, would tell you differently. I think the beauty of it is difficult, it can be exhausting, it can be thankless, but at the end of the day, you know that you've done the right thing for the right reasons, whatever that might be. As much a part of my job is making sure we get people out of jail that don't need to be in jail as it is making sure we get people sent to prison for as long as the law allows, if that's what they need. So we kind of carry both of those torches equally as prosecutors. It is an equal responsibility to pursue the guilty while we're protecting the innocent. So yes, it is difficult. The caseload is tremendous. The pressure is great because the stakes are so high.
I think I saw a number that there's something like 108 prosecutors in the office, and 100, is this correct, something 110, 130,000
yes,
cases?
That's correct.
I mean, that's an amazing number.
It is.
And yet, your office over the years has certainly been pointed to as one who has a great deal of efficiencies. On the administrative side, what makes a district attorney's office more or less efficient?
Well, I think our greatest resource, as with any office, it is the people that work there, the people that come in every day, day in and day out, and do the best job that they can for the community, no matter what their role is in our office. We all have a very important role, and we talk a lot about the work that trial attorneys put into presenting a case to a jury. You know, if it's a two-week sequestered trial and hundreds of exhibits and cameras and people and all of that, but before we ever got to that point, there were many, many people behind the scenes working many, many hours to get that case ready. Secretaries and investigators and victim witness coordinators, and just that is our greatest resource, are the people that we have.
And I mean, what has been one of your worst or hardest cases, I guess? Worst isn't the right word, but one of the most difficult cases you've been through that has pulled on all those resources, those good resources you've talked about.
Mine personally or as an office?
Yeah,
or
you personally.
I mean, any death penalty case, any murder first case, you know, quite frankly, any gang case where you've got a list of witnesses that don't want to cooperate with you, that takes extra resources and extra energy on our part, because we've got a job to do, and that job is to present that case to the public and let a jury decide it. And so if we've got to spend extra energy getting people rounded up and into court to tell what they know to the jury, we're going to do that. But it's hard to single out,
sure,
you know, one particular case that's been more exhausting than any other, because they all have varying degrees of difficulty. And quite frankly, sometimes it's the ones that kind of slip under the radar that can tend to be just as exhausting, because you're dealing with people,
yeah,
and real life people with real lives and issues, and we're asking them to drop everything and come into court and help us prosecute a defendant.
You mentioned the death penalty. You've argued a number of death penalty cases. That is, probably the most serious thing a prosecutor can do, the most serious cases, mm-hmm, most serious offenses, most serious outcome.
Mm-hmm.
Is that difficult? I mean, to know that you're putting that man or woman's life, you know, before the jury and asking them to take that life.
Sure. And it's, quite frankly, it's the same difficulty whether we're seeking the death penalty or whether it's a DUI, because if we are asking a jury to convict somebody, we've got to know in our heart of hearts that we're on target and that this person is guilty for this crime. Now, with the death penalty, because the punishment is the ultimate punishment, it adds that extra layer to the case. But yes, they are very difficult, and you know, of course, you're dealing with a family whose loved one was taken from them in a tragic way,
mm-hmm,
and all of those factors weigh into making not only the death penalty case, but anytime you're holding a mother whose daughter was murdered, regardless of what the punishment is that the defendant is facing, it's a difficult day at the office.
You mentioned being a mother. You're a parent.
I
have children, I think I read somewhere in an article that, I mean, you know, certainly in the courtroom, 8 months pregnant, you know, arguing these serious cases. Is that part of the do you have to separate in your personal life? Everyone does, I suppose, on some degree. You know, you separate your personal life and your work life. Yours is maybe particularly difficult sometimes.
It can be, and I'll tell you, a bad day at the office, nothing can make up for that, like walking home and walking in the door and having your 5-year-old run into your arms and think you're the greatest thing, no matter what happened in the courtroom that day or in the office. But it can be difficult, particularly if, you know, mom's on the front page of the paper,
right,
or something mom is doing is in
right,
the paper or on the news. My kids they're amazing, though. They, I've told many, many people that my 4 children and my husband are what motivate me and what inspire me to make Shelby County a stronger community, not only for the Weirich household, but all of the families out there.
It's interesting you talk about the community. I mean, crime is such an issue that defines so much of the dialogue, the civic dialogue,
mm-hmm,
in Memphis. I've,
mm-hmm,
been in Memphis about 15 years, and it really, you know, invades a whole lot of things. I mean, on the personal level, obviously, and you've,
sure,
talked about to some extent, but also on the broader sense, the sense of community spirit or lack,
sure,
thereof, and feeling good, and you know, the ridiculous Forbes rankings and those kinds of things. Where is your responsibility lie in that, in the broadest civic sense of handling crime?
Well, it's a huge responsibility, because quite frankly, the prosecutors in the courtroom are kind of the last line of defense, and we've got to make sure as an office that we've got tough laws that we can use as prosecutors, but we've also got to have tough prosecutors willing to use those laws and use the tools that are given to us. So if you've got a situation where, you know, a defendant is willing to plead guilty for a certain number of years, but you've looked at the facts and you've looked at this defendant's record, and quite frankly, this is somebody that deserves and has earned a little more serious sentence, as a prosecutor, you've got to be willing to stand up tall and strong and say, no, we're not going to make a deal on this case. We're going to go to trial if you don't take this offer.
And crime, you know, over the last 4 years is down. The violent crime is down pretty, you know, 24%. Do you see that trend continuing? And what does your office do? We've talked about trying cases and putting, you know, criminals in jail. What do you do proactively, or is there anything you can do proactively to keep that crime rate going down? Because by the time they get to you, the crime is committed.
Exactly. And what we have gotten very good at doing as a District Attorney General's office, and I credit all of this to Bill Gibbons and the men and women of Operation Safe Community, is realizing that the District Attorney General's office can't sit in 201 Poplar, and the police director can't sit on the 12th floor, and the sheriff can't sit on the 9th floor, and the mayor's down here, and the community service people down here, and the faith-based organization all over town. We've all got to get together, and we've got to get at the table, and we've got to talk about these issues, and we've got to talk about how we as a group can address them. And we're doing that and have been doing that in some very exciting ways. One of the hottest topics going on right now is a discussion of youth violence. Memphis is selected as one of the 6 cities in the country to participate in the National Forum on Youth Violence. And what we've been doing for countless hours is all of those people, as well as the community, and getting feedback from teenagers themselves and parents of teenagers all over the county as to violence and youth violence and why we have so many children hurting children and then becoming adults who commit crimes. So that is an area that we are being proactive in. Several of us will travel to Washington, D.C. in a few weeks to take part in a national discussion on this. And so youth violence is one, and we've also gotten more proactive in terms of nuisance petitions. When we go in and we shut down a home or we shut down a business because the people that were occupying it have chosen not to follow the law and have created a menace on the street, we're certainly going to do something about that. And we do that with the cooperation of the police department, the sheriff's department, whoever, and we go in and we shut them down. And we send the message to those on the street, those businesses that are neighbors, we're not going to put up with it. You shouldn't have to as neighbors, and we're not going to stand for it anymore. So there certainly are proactive things that we do and that we will continue to do.
You've been appointed to this position. You, I think, have said that you're going to run for the position in 2012. Yes. What is it like to move from being a prosecutor and administrator to looking at the campaign trail and all the promises you have to make and the commitments you have to make there?
Well, and really, I guess as district attorney, it's a little bit easier than other people that are on the campaign trail, because as the district attorney and as the candidate for district attorney, it doesn't matter. As long as I'm occupying that office, my responsibility to this community is to pursue the guilty and protect the innocent. And I can't, by any stretch of the imagination, nor would I want to, start creating an agenda or, you know, making some campaign platform that was out of touch with what the community was telling me.
And you talk about the community and how your office works. There's been pretty close coordination between your office, the police department, mm-hmm. and the sheriff's department. Mm-hmm. And crime, as we had said, is down 24%,
yes.
25%. We're at a time of a lot of change in leadership.
Sure.
Sheriff Oldham has won election in the fall. Police Chief Godwin is mm-hmm. retiring. Mm-hmm. Does that create opportunities for changing what's going on, for tweaking what's going on, specifically in the ways in which you work with the police department and the sheriff's department?
Well, I hope not, because I think we've got a great system in place. And the good thing about, even though I'm new to the particular office that I'm occupying, I've been in the DA's office for 20 years. So I'm known to the police, I'm known to the sheriff's deputies, I'm known to the people in and out of 201 Poplar. The system and the way we function is not new to me. And the same with Sheriff Oldham. I mean, the man's been in law enforcement for many, many, many years on both sides, mm-hmm. Memphis Police Department, Sheriff's Department. He's seen it all and done it all. So he's a great leader for this community. He's someone whose advice I certainly seek from time to time, because he knows what to do. And the same with the police chief. You know, hopefully whoever the mayor appoints will be someone who has had prior police experience and will come in and be willing and ready and able to continue making the history that we're making in Shelby County.
The police department and the change in leadership there, what are your feelings about Blue Crush? I mean, I think a lot of people are in favor. Some people feel like, well, it's all data-driven, but it's not. It's too data-driven. It's too much technology, not enough, you know, feet on the street type policing. I mean, what has been your experience with that program specifically?
It's a great tool for us as prosecutors because what it, you know, it tells us kind of where we need to be, where the trouble areas are. And I think we all know that if you have an area where drug crime is going on or where property crimes are going on, that's more than likely going to lead to other crimes. I mean, you can look at Dr. Janikowski's maps from the University of Memphis and see kind of the hot spots for crime activity, and it makes sense that that's where we put our resources. Of course it would be great if Director Godwin had enough police officers to not only do the Blue Crush as strenuously and as successfully as we've been doing, but to have more boots on the ground. But, you know, that's something that we all know comes down to very limited capital. But I think it's a great tool, and it's worked very well.
Who sets your, and forgive me for not knowing this, but who sets your budget?
My budget is about half from the state of Tennessee and about half from Shelby County. And a little bit of that is grants.
Right. And how do you go about, I mean, you probably would say, as I'm sure Chief Godwin would say, you know, I don't have quite enough people. Maybe I don't have near enough people. Is that a process of talking to the state and talking? I mean, how do you raise money and fund the department, and what's your role in that?
My role is kind of the voice, and if I think there were some, you know, studies done a few years ago that indicated based upon the caseload that our office carries, we should have about 26 more prosecutors than we do right now. Mm-hmm. Again, we all know that means a lot of money. We've gotten, I believe, 7 to 9 of those 26 funded. A lot of that has come through the county commission, mm-hmm. recognizing that yes, extra prosecutors are going to help, and here's how they're going to help, and seeing that need and thankfully filling it. And you know, it'll be interesting to see if there's any money in Governor Haslam's budget Monday
right.
night and, for and more the, prosecutors.
Right.
And we will find out
the
when
the smart money says there isn't. I mean, with the
exactly.
budget pressure that's on the state, that
exactly.
you know, really most departments, most areas, trying to hold on to what they have.
Exactly. So we just make do with what we have. And you know, the other thing. When you add, if you were to throw a bunch of prosecutors into the DA's office, that would be a great thing. However, we're busting at the seams at 201 Poplar and the other office spaces that we occupy, as are the other offices that occupy 201 Poplar. So, you know, sometimes that's not the easy solution. And then with that, you also need more support staff and more of other things. So it's a ball that gets thrown down the hill.
Your predecessor and boss, Bill Gibbons,
yes.
was known for being in Nashville lobbying for changes in the law. He was
yes.
a real active voice up there for tougher sentencing, for
yes.
all kinds of things. Do you see that as part of your role?
Oh, sure. I've already made a trip to D.C. lobbying for money for things that would benefit not only prosecutors but public defenders. And of course, we are very, very active right now with legislative session that's going on, and there are several bills before them that we are very interested in as district attorneys statewide, public safety coalition issues, things like that. So yes, we
name some of the bills that you'd really want to see pushed, and some of the things you'd like to see the state do.
Sure. I mean, there's a lot of talk about making school zones, stretching the boundaries and the crimes. If a certain crime is committed within a school zone, we get to add on extra sentencing, and there's an enhancement there for doing that, a violent crime or things like that, kind of like the drug-free school zone mm-hmm. situation, but stretching that into violent crimes. Also, you know, the battle that's waging with pseudoephedrine and methamphetamine and the different approaches that we can take with that. There's a bill that's been presented that deals with drive-by shootings, which is a horrible problem that we see, particularly in the gangs, and usually if a car drives by a home and unloads one gun or several guns into that home, the best we can do is kind of a low-grade felony. But with this bill, it would allow us to get a little extra sentencing, a little more time on the books, and make that defendant serve a little bit more time before they're back out.
There, talk about, I mentioned Operation Blue Crush. There are a number of operations, coordinated, you know, efforts with the police department and other areas of local government. Clean Sweep is one.
Mm-hmm.
Talk about that for a second and what Operation Clean Sweep is about.
And you're talking about the nuisances
and the drug
houses?
Yes.
The one that we just closed down this week, I think, was Clean Sweep 32 or 33 or something. And that's basically, you know, what I was speaking of earlier. Homes in neighborhoods that are used as retail drug markets are what we go in and we board them up and we shut them down and we send the message, we're not going to put up with it.
And how do programs like that, I think either we did a story or a story I read that was about someone saying, yeah, that's helpful, but it's just going to move down the street. And what that whole notion of when you target an area, mm-hmm. you know, I'm sure the area, the people in that area are happy to see the drug folks pushed out, but if it's just going to push it down the street and 6 months down the road, they're going to get pushed from that street back to this street. How do you make those kinds of efforts stick?
Well, and one thing we've done is, first of all, send the message that we're going to be there and we're going to catch you no matter what. But what we have to do is kind of get at the root of this and the cause and effect kind of thing. One very successful initiative that we have tried and executed is what is called DMI, the Drug Market Initiative, where you go into the open-air drug markets and you send the message to the community that we're going to make these streets safer and we're going to be there, but we're going to leave it kind of in your hands, and that it's not going to be necessarily the police that dive in and fix the problem and then pull off the street and get out of there, but we need the community to buy in to what we're doing and to take some pride in their neighborhood.
What is an open-air drug market? I mean, define that.
Literally, standing on the sidewalk. Selling
visibly,
your drugs and wares.
I mean,
exactly.
If I were to drive by there right now, it'd be 100% clear what's going on. And so what can community people who, I mean, I would think, you know, one reaction would be, well, they've got guns and I don't. I'm just trying to protect my family. I mean, how does the community buy in, as you're saying, and address that kind of open-air drug market?
Sure, and it's something that has been tried in many, many different cities, and we participated in kind of the training of it, several of us within Memphis, and then we rolled it out in the Hollywood-Springdale area a year ago, and the big component of it is not only that the police are going to swarm in and get the drug dealers off the street, but we had the cooperation of the U.S. Attorney's Office, and so a lot of these drug dealers that were selling one and two rocks of crack cocaine, because of their records, mm-hmm. have been sent away in the federal system for many, 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 many years, many more than the state could do. The other plate that is kind of spinning when you do the open-air drug market and the DMI initiative is this sense of community pride. And the biggest struggle that we had is building up the trust between the neighborhood and the police department. And we have made great headway with that. And the police officers in the Old Allen Station and the COAC in that area will tell you that they're getting a lot more neighbors calling the police and saying, I think something suspicious is going on.
Does that come down to a level of trust?
Of course.
I can trust that these police will respond. I can trust then that the bad guys will be put in jail and not come back and cause
and retaliate or whatever. Because there's more of a presence with the police and there is the reciprocal trust from the neighbors. Because what the community saw was not only those of us from downtown zooming in and getting the bad guys off the street and leaving the neighborhood. We picked people who had never had serious criminal problems before, and we said, you know what, we've got you on audio tape, we've got you on videotape, we'll show it to you here, you're caught red-handed. If you do these things that we're asking you to do, we'll tear up this indictment and you won't go to prison. And we helped them get jobs, get GEDs, get job training skills, and so we were able to take five people and say to them, you're done selling drugs, you're going to find a way to succeed in this community, and we're going to help you. And so,
Or else.
Right. But so the rest of the neighbors saw that. Everybody was called to this, it's called a call-in session, and you're brought in and you're told, you're caught and you're shown the video and you see.
How do the police respond to that? I can imagine that there could be police officers who say, hey, I just caught that guy,
sure.
and you just, why aren't you putting him behind bars? I mean, I imagine there's some amount of tension between your office and police officers in that sense.
Well, and the beauty of this program, and quite frankly, when Bill Gibbons told me I was going to go to Raleigh, North Carolina with some officers of the Memphis Police Department and prosecutor from the U.S. Attorney's Office and some leaders in the social services areas of town for this program, my first response was, you know, it's kind of hug a thug. It's not going to do anything. Okay, I'll go because my boss is telling me to.
Hug a thug, not in a good way.
Not in a good way.
With a bit of cynicism.
Not in a good way. Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly. And there was not one of us sitting at that table that day. Police officers, veteran, tough police officers, veteran, tough federal prosecutors, and myself, who when we heard these other cities talk about, Nashville has done it, Philadelphia, areas outside of Detroit, North Carolina, New York, all of these major metropolitan areas that have a lot of the same issues we do. When we heard these people talk about how successful it was, we all looked at each other and said, we've got to do this. We owe this to the community. And so from that point on, it then became our responsibility to come back and get the rest of the DA's office fired up, the rest of the police department fired up, and the social services and faith-based community fired up. And we were fortunate to be able to do that.
And really briefly, we have about a minute left. I know that domestic violence is something you've said is a priority for your office. In just maybe 30 seconds, talk about some of the efforts you want to put forth there.
Sure. We have a great, hardworking domestic violence unit, and we have a courtroom designated to nothing but handling domestic violence cases. And we also have the upcoming opening of the Family Safety Center, which will help to give services to victims and their family members who have been victimized by domestic violence under one roof instead of sending them all over town. But we just have got to get the numbers of domestic violence crime down.
And we'll leave it there. Thank you very much for joining us. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us. Good night.